scientists have discovered many different queer chemical bonds in nature, like the one between bisexuals and Loki, the they-them and high-waisted pants alliance, asexuals, and all of the extra time they have to do meaningful things in life because they're not chasing sex. They're living better lives. But there's one bond that's impenetrable, and that's the one between the girls and the gays. What is the science behind this bond? And can we see examples of it in nature? And why did I drink so much milk as a kid? Like, every night for dinner, I had a full glass of cow's milk. We're gonna answer all these questions, except for that last one. I'm Rob Anderson, and this is Gay Science. Queer phenomenons have existed since the beginning of the observable universe. Now we're using real science and super true facts to understand how overwhelmingly homosexual our world really is. Join me in looking at different branches of science to discover what's gay and what's gayer. Remember to subscribe, it's homophobic not to. And welcome to Gay Science. In today's episode, why do women and gay men get along so well? After decades of the gay best friend trope dominating entertainment, you might think that gay men are just an accessory to women, that straight women are out there collecting gays like Pokemon, and then discarding them as soon as a hot straight guy comes around. And what about lesbians? Do they even mix well with the gays? We never really see them in the dark rooms. These tropes are outliers that overshadow a long-standing beneficial relationship between the two groups. A professor of gay bestie studies at the Grammatica Institute found a unique chemical connection between the gay man and females that isn't seen anywhere else in science. These bonds create an ecological interaction that has a net benefit for shelter, protection, and nutrition. For lesbians and gay men, it's the gayonic bond, a hyper-strong electrostatic attraction between oppositely charged homosexuals. Their differences pull them together, like a queer magnet. Gay men provide good company for queer women who want to enjoy a friendship with a man without the unwelcome advances. In return, queer women keep gay men grounded. Thirsty gays can really gas each other up simply to increase their chances of a hookup, but lesbians do no such thing. They keep it real. For straight women and gay men, it's the gay valent bond. They share an electron that makes them both attracted to and disappointed by men. It also causes several other similarities, like always going out of their way to return a shopping cart, a passion for organized fitness, and getting the Gardasil shot. Gay men will give straight women valuable feedback on their relationships with men, manslate, and help call out red flags. In return, gays get to see the dick pics. Women and gay men have relied on one another for survival since the beginning of time, and the human race wouldn't be here if it weren't for this bond. Neanderthals went extinct due to the birth of a superior modern human genome. This happened when lesbians were surrogates with gay men for the very first time, and they accidentally created a better species together. Writing was invented by the girls and the gays so they could pass notes to each other discreetly and talk without getting caught. In the modern age, a few new types of bonds between the two started to form. Here, girls enjoy being around a boy they can actually trust, and the gays could really use the friendship. These are corporate besties who send each other gay memes all day. This bond is why a mother's strength grows at least 100 times when they're around their gay sons. It's why English teachers and their gay students have a certain understanding with each other and can communicate on the same level. A woman is a better listener than any man, and a gay therapy patient is guaranteed income forever. Then there's the bond between gay men and the older actresses who they talk about as if they know them personally. This is a one-sided bond. The gay best friend trope in media is tiring, but there are plenty of mutually beneficial gay valent and gayonic bonds in media. You just have to know to look for them. It was a gay alien that reached out to Amy Adams to warn her about the future of Earth. It took a little girl to teach a gay man who was really in his feelings about the true meaning of Christmas. Euphoria's bisexual Rue and probably gay Fez bond over drugs and a mutual respect for one another. Sandy, an unquestionably lesbian squirrel who has gal pals, loves karate, is into bodybuilding, and is a rodeo champion, is balanced by the gay icon SpongeBob. It was Damien's gay theatrics that allowed him to play Santa so convincingly it caused Gretchen Wieners to rightfully doubt an unhealthy friendship. And Bowser isn't the heterosexual villain, he's just a gay turtle looking out for Princess Peach by keeping her away from a very toxic Mario, because he's the only one who knows that it's actually Chris Pratt. That is our episode for today. Gay Science is made possible by support to your local barista, so be sure to tip them, and by viewers like you. So please like the video, leave a comment on what Gay Science should tackle next, and subscribe so you don't miss any future Gay Science videos. I'm Rob Anderson, and until next time, stay bi-curious.